Hey ladies, it is Money Mindset Monday, and I just want to welcome you. If you are new here, it's an honor and a blessing to have you here. And, you know, I just started this group maybe 3 weeks ago, and we are growing small beginnings, but I know it's going to have such amazing things to come. I love the people who have been going live and sharing about their heart, their stories. Would really just encourage you. This is a place where you can be vulnerable, you can be visible, you can practice that. And I just want to be a role model for that as well today, sharing my very vulnerable money story in case you don't know it. I feel like money is something that is so sensitive. And it's something that is very hard, especially as Christian women, for us to talk about. There's just so much emotion that's tied up into it about our own self-worth. You know, are we good enough to be doing what we're doing? There's a lot of fear. There's just so much doubt about, you know, what we're doing and putting ourselves out there. So I just want to share my heart, my story, in case you don't know. Just because I've been through it all, there is nothing anymore that surprises me. There is nothing I can say, yeah, that's not going to happen to me. I've just learned that that's not something that's in my control. But it's amazing looking back now. I'm able to connect all the dots, all the things that I've been through. So just want to share my story. And I grew up in a small town, Minnesota, just in a very loving but very frugal family. The richest man in town was someone I idolized. He had this like octagonal house. It was the 80s in on the river. And I'm like, when I grow up, I'm going to have a house just like that. And he was the mayor of the city. He flew in palm trees and planted them along Main Street, like 20 palm trees in Minnesota for the summer. He would dig them out and then, you know, put them back wherever they go. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have palm trees in Minnesota when I grow up. And, you know, then I found out a couple years later, he was still mayor, but he ended up being a drug dealer, went to jail. I think he's probably still there. And I just remember thinking like, oh gosh, I don't want to be rich. Like, rich people are evil. They're bad. They're not nice people. You know, never mind. I don't want money. You know, just another thing that really influenced me as a child is I just saw my father working so hard. He worked as an insurance agent in our small town, but he would come home every single day and he would have to, for lunch. We had lunch as a family. My mom made him dinner or lunch. But my sister and I remember being instructed to play super quietly because dad needs to lay down. You know, he's got to kind of recover. You have to work really hard. You can't enjoy what you're doing. Like, it has to be stressful and it affects your health. And so I just grew up with all sorts of crazy stories that, you know, until you really start addressing this on your own, which is almost impossible to do, you are still making decisions about money as a 3-year-old, as an 8-year-old, a 12-year-old, whatever. You know, whenever you started believing those stories, it's really just kind of been a loop that's like replaying in your head. And you probably don't even question a lot of these things now. Oh, money's hard. You have to work really hard. It can't be easy or joyful. And that was my story. I worked as an occupational therapist at a group home until I had kids. And you guys, that was draining. That was hard. And I did not enjoy it at all. But I didn't even question it. It was just what I had to do, you know, full time to pay off my student loans until I had my kids. And then my dream was to be a stay-at-home mom. I wanted to be there and be present and not miss out on any of the memories. But my husband at the time, he worked for the family business. His mother owned a pretty well-to-do business here in the Twin Cities, and, you know, with the promise that he would be president, taking it over very shortly. So we were trying to buy out the business. We refinanced our house. We put $200,000 into it. We bought out his brothers, and within the next year, his mom fired him. So this was really difficult because, I mean, not only it affected our finances, we had been planning on, you know, buying out the business, him taking more, but he's always kind of had a little bit of bipolar disorder, and I feel like that stressful situation really threw him for a loop. There was so many quirky things going on, including him writing in Latin all over our walls of the house. But that really brought out that diagnosis. He became super manic, and about the same time I was diagnosed with cancer. So obviously not a great combination. We had three little kids. I had surgery. I had radiation. I had to take a leave of absence from my job, and it was a super horrible and stressful time for us. It just ended up being too much for him, and one day after I was out running errands, I came home and he was sitting on the porch and he had a backpack on, and he's like, I'm out of here. This is not fun anymore. And I think I still get kind of speechless. Like, I had no clue what was going on and didn't know what to say. But the thing that he told me right before he walked out the door is he said, I just also need to let you know I don't believe in God. I haven't since I was 15, but I just played along because I knew how important it was to you. So at that point, even though I still wanted to try, I'm not one for giving up. I really wanted to do counseling, and we did it. We were separated for a year. But it just... those foundational levels, we were not on the same page. And I just knew that even though the rug had been completely swept out from under me, that there was no way that I could be married to someone like that. So that started, you know, my whole independent financial journey. This was not something that I really did much with, to be honest, which is, you know, I know it needs to be a partnership, but he had a finance degree and I trusted him as his wife. Not knowing that he had been taking out credit cards in our names, and we were about $70,000 in debt when I found that out. Now, after he got fired, he was also self-employed, so there was no way that we could garnish his wages for child support. So, as a mother of three young kids living in our house, even with three jobs, what I made during a month did not even cover our mortgage. So we were living off an advance from my 401k and my savings, and it was just not sustainable. I knew this could not keep going, and our house fell into foreclosure. This was probably the worst, darkest, most shameful time. Remember the first time, so you guys probably don't know what this process is like, but a sheriff, a policeman actually has to come to your door. They park in front of your house. They have to physically hand you over the sheriff's sale papers for their documentation. And I mean, there's all sorts of legal stuff going on. I remember Jonah, he was, I think, 8 at the time. He answered the door. I was in the kitchen. He came running into the kitchen. He was like, Mom, there's a policeman at the door. They want to talk to you. Of course, I am completely shocked. I had no idea what was going on. And I walked to the door and it kind of clipped, like, all of a sudden. And I literally, like, backed up. I was going to hide because I was mortified. I just, it was so shameful. I'm not the type of person who does not, you know, go forward with what I said I was going to do. And yet there was no way that I could make that monthly payment. So I don't think I even looked him in the eyes. I had tears in my eyes. I took the papers, shut the door. Jonah asked what was going on. I couldn't even explain. I'm like, I mumbled something. I have no clue what. And that started off. That was in June of 2015, and I was trying to make ends meet. I was trying to protect them. I didn't want my kids to know of what was going on, and yet There was nothing I could do until one evening in August of 2015. I was working, you know, all three of my jobs. Our air conditioner was broke. We were sweating, eating our peanut butter and jelly sandwiches in the kitchen. And I remember telling the kids, like, guys, I just needed to prepare them. I told them, you know, things needed to change. We needed to cut out their beloved activities. It was basketball for Jonah, competitive gymnastics for Amelie. She was so good. And then dance for Bella. And they were trying to be so brave, and they were sitting there kind of nodding, and I could see the fear in their eyes. And I quickly excused myself to the bathroom before I started bawling in front of them. And I was just sobbing into the towels. Don't even know how long I was there, but I heard a little knock at the door. And I opened it up, and Amelie, my youngest, she was standing there, and she had her little pink cheetah print suitcase. She had quickly run up to her room. She filled it with all of her stuff, and she was like, "Mom, we're going to be okay. I have stuff for us to sell." And I, that girl broke my heart wide open at that moment. It was filled with like doll clothes and nail polish and rocks and seashells, and you know, just that childlike faith was the thing that changed everything for me. And from that day on, I was just like, "Lord, I surrender. I obviously have no clue what I'm doing here. I can't do this alone. And I am not going to have my youngest daughter thinking that she needs to figure this out for me." And so I just remember being on my knees and praying and asking the Lord for help. And that was really the start. Because one of my jobs was as a health coach. I believed that I went through cancer and all those horrible experiences so I could help empower other women. I was a health coach for moms with cancer. And I was just like, I went through this for a reason. I felt so strongly that this was the Lord, something that the Lord wanted me to do, and yet I was not making any money because of my own money mindset. You know, I was giving away my time. I was not valuing what I was able to do. I, of course, had a servant's heart, as I believe all of you do, but I just kept giving and giving and giving, and I was not making any money, which is obviously not a sustainable way to do business. And so I really kind of set out to just increase my faith and my trust in the Lord and get really smart about how to create a profitable and sustainable business. So I started reading. I started taking certifications. I probably have at least 10 different certifications, including a certified financial master coach, transformational wealth coach. I mean, but this was just for myself. I never had a clue, here's another but God, that something that scared me so much, that brought me so much fear, could ever be something that I would do to help other women. And yet the transformation that I have been through, the things that I've learned through the Lord, what He has shown me through the Bible, you know, through kingdom principles, is nothing I could have ever experienced for myself. And that's why I'm so incredibly passionate right now about helping other women, because I believe that you were given experiences and stories and gifts for a reason, that God has placed the desires of your heart. And the word desires, the D-E, means of the, and then sire, S-I-R-E, means of the Father. I believe He has placed those desires in your heart for a reason, and that when He places them there and we listen to Him and His calling for our life, that we can change the world to glorify Him. And so that's why I felt the fear, and I held myself back for so many years. And that's why I don't want any other women to feel the same way that I did. I believe we need to own the gifts that He has been given us, to really get out of our own way, to stop holding ourselves back, stop making it all about ourselves, and really focus on those that we want to serve. Who are the women or the groups the people that are out there right now praying for what you and only you have. I know that you are here for a reason, and there is no need, you know, to dim your light, that we've gone through what we have for a reason, and God wants us to help others, to serve others, to love others, to bring hope and redemption to others. So that is why I do what I do. And since then, my life has completely changed. We were able to live in that house through 13 different sheriff sales. I just got used to the sheriff setting new dates. They would come over. There was one morning I walked out on a Saturday morning to let the dog out the back door, and there was a sheriff sitting at my patio table waiting for me. You know, I lost all fear during that time. Like, what can you do, except for just rely on the Lord and the plans that He has for you? So 13 different times at the Ramsey County Sheriff's courthouse, it fell through. No one ever had an explanation. Lawyers, bankers, our mortgage company, all these crazy people were involved, and no one ever had an explanation of why it fell through. But God had plans for us. I was trying to make ends meet. I was trying to do everything I could for my kids, but God had us. I didn't have to make more because He had a plan for us to live in that house for 6 years and 2 months without a payment. We saved, I think it was like $227,000 because He took care of us, because He's a good father, because I didn't have to do it alone. I would have never come up with a plan like this. You know, most people say you can live in a foreclosed home for up to a year at the most. But He has plans for every single one of us, and He has a plan for you. And that's just, we can let go of the fear. We can let go of our own insecurities when we are able to really dig deep into Him as our Father. He wants good things. He has good plans for us. And just when we're able to surrender maybe what we had planned for His better plans, oh my gosh, like that's just when the magic happens. So I just want to encourage you to just dig deep, to ask Him to really get grounded in who you are, in your identity as a daughter of the King. And if you are not, you know, reading the word every day, that's just honestly the best way that you can do this. So I would invite you to be vulnerable in here, to ask questions, to go live, to be visible. This is a really safe place, and I want to help you guys. I want your businesses to be profitable, to be sustainable, to be a light, to shine God's love and glory to others. And I really believe that we can do that when we are able to show His love and goodness that He has for us. Share your stories, share your struggles, be vulnerable. It's okay. So that's my super crazy story. Personally, now I am married to the man of my dreams. I've been praying for him, I think, for probably my whole life. We've been married. It will be 3 years in November, but you guys, I went through the divorce, I never thought there would be someone out there for me, but we were married. He was 48 years old, never married. He always wanted to be a father. On our first date, he said, I knew I would be a father. I didn't know if I would be a biological father, but He has taken on my kids, and I just could not have asked for a better ending to our story. We were able to build and live in our dream home now, and it's just amazing, like when you are able to fully step into the plans that God has for you, and that's what I want for each and every one. So I am here for you. I offer free strategy sessions at all times. Please reach out if that is something that you think would be beneficial. It's just a free 15-minute call to see where you're at, see where you want to be, and how I can help you get there. So That's my story. Would love to know yours. Introduce yourself, why you're here, how I can help you and your biz, and I'll talk to you later. Bye for now, guys.